are just joining us today, we are at the end of what I hope has been an encouraging and enjoyable series inspired by Marvel's monumental movie, Avengers Endgame. As the culmination of 20-plus movies, Endgame made a colossal cultural impact on its march to becoming the highest-grossing movie of all time. And in this movie, you know, needless to say, it has made an undeniable mark on popular culture. And for that reason, I think Endgame is worth examining through the lens of faith. For the last 3 weeks, I've been deconstructing some of the characters and concepts from this movie to see what we can learn about life, faith, and God. Last Sunday, I spotlighted my personal favorite Avenger, Captain America, and by wielding Thor's mighty hammer Mjolnir, Captain America proved himself worthy. And like Captain America, Christians are also called to live lives worthy of the gospel, which requires conviction, the determination to stand strong, whatever comes our way. It requires cooperation, you know, this ability to work together as one. It requires contending, you know, fighting the good fight of faith. And finally, it requires courage, you know, not being intimidated, not being afraid of whatever opposition comes our way. And these four virtues characterize not only Captain America, but also Christians who are living lives worthy of the gospel. And as we bring this series to a close today, I would be remiss if I didn't include the two Avengers who made the ultimate sacrifice. In two of the most dramatic moments of the movie, Black Widow and Iron Man each sacrifice their lives to save the universe and to defeat the treacherous Titan Thanos. And the deaths of these beloved comic book characters spurred strong emotional responses from fans, many of them, you know, wiping tears from their cheeks in the movie theaters. And what moviegoers might have missed, however, are the powerful parallels between the deaths of these characters and the death of Jesus Christ. And whether or not these parallels were intentional, these cinematic sacrifices take on greater resonance when viewed through a Christian lens. Much like, you know, Black Widow and Iron Man, Jesus sacrificed his own life to save the world. And I'd like to point out three provocative parallels between the deaths of these superheroes and the death of our Savior. First, these heroic deaths were all voluntary. They were voluntary. Have you ever volunteered for something before? Maybe when you were a kid, you volunteered to help mom out around the house or volunteered to mow the lawn. I don't know, maybe today you volunteer for various community programs or school programs or just volunteering here around church. There's a big difference, isn't there, between volunteering yourself for something, you know, willingly giving of yourself for some cause or purpose, and just being, you know, doing something out of obligation or being forced to do something. You know, one of the reasons that Black Widow and Iron Man's deaths were so emotional for audiences is that neither of them were killed by their enemy. Rather, they both laid down their lives willingly, voluntarily. And this is especially true of Black Widow. While on their quest to acquire the Soul Stone, one of the six Infinity Stones, Black Widow and Hawkeye travel to a desolate world called Vormir, where they face a seemingly impossible decision. Let's watch this scene.
What you seek lies in front of you. Does what you fear.
The stone's down there.
For one of you. For the other. In order to take the stone, you must lose that which you love. An everlasting exchange. A soul for a soul.
If we don't get that stone, billions of people stay dead.
And I guess we both know who it's gotta be.
I guess we do.
I'm starting to think we mean different people here, Natasha.
The last 5 years I've been trying to do one thing, get to raid here. That's all it's been about, bringing everybody back.
No, don't you get all decent on me now.
What, you think I want to do it? I'm trying to save your life, you idiot.
Yeah, well, I don't want you to. How's that? Natasha, you know what I've done. You know what I've become.
I don't judge people on their worst mistakes.
Widow and Hawkeye, knowing what was at stake and how many people were counting on them, were willing to give their lives, so much so that they were literally fighting each other for the opportunity to sacrifice themselves. In the end, Black Widow's life wasn't taken from her, it was freely given. And the same is true for Jesus. You know, before Jesus ever arrived at the cross, he said in John chapter 10, "The Father loves me because I sacrifice my life so I may take it back again. No one can take my life from me. I sacrifice it voluntarily, for I have the authority to lay it down when I want to and also to take it back again." When we reflect on the brutality and the bloodshed of the cross, you know, that Jesus experienced there on the cross, we might wonder, couldn't Jesus have stopped it? I mean, couldn't he have done something to prevent, to not have to endure the cross? I mean, this is the Son of God, for goodness sakes. He's all powerful, right? I mean, surely when the soldier raised the mallet to drive the nail through his hand with the flex of his bicep and the clench of his fist, Jesus could have resisted, could have fought back. I mean, as the old hymn says, he could have called 10,000 angels to destroy the world and set him free. But he didn't. He chose to sacrifice himself willingly, voluntarily, and that's what makes it so much more meaningful. And the Romans who nailed Jesus to the cross, they didn't take his life. He gave it. Had the soldier hesitated, Jesus just would have swung the hammer himself. I mean, he knew how. He was no stranger to driving nails. As a carpenter, he knew what it took. And as a savior, he knew what it meant. And as the hand of Jesus opened for the spike, the doors of heaven opened for you and me. When the world needed a Savior, Jesus volunteered and he gave his life. And so first, these valiant deaths were voluntary. But furthermore, all of these deaths were also vicarious. Vicarious means taking the place of another person or being a substitute for them. And both Iron Man and Black Widow's deaths were vicarious because they died in order to save other people, in order that others could live. And this, again, is especially evident in Black Widow's death. In the clip that we just watched, Black Widow pleads with Hawkeye to let her be the one to die. She says, "I'm trying to save your life, you idiot." But Clint, Hawkeye, he responds by saying, "Yeah, well, I don't want you to. How about that?" And he says, "You know what I've done. You know what I've become." And if you were here for the first sermon in this series, you'll remember Hawkeye's story that at the very beginning, the first 2 minutes of the movie, he lost his family, his wife and three kids. And he didn't take that loss well. You know, he went on this very violent and bloody vendetta. You know, he becomes this grief-stricken vigilante, violently wreaking bloody revenge on whatever bad guys he can catch. But despite all that, Natasha graciously replies, "Well, I don't judge people on their worst mistakes." And to be honest, this scene did not sit well with me. You know, I walked out of the theater thinking, that should have been Hawkeye. Hawkeye should have been the one that died in that scene. You know, as they're fighting to go over, you're not really sure who's going to be the one to die. I was certain that Hawkeye should have been the one to die. I mean, he did a lot of bad things. You know, he murdered people. That's not okay. Maybe you should judge people on their worst mistakes, I thought. And he's out there doing all this bad stuff, and yet he gets to go home to his wife and kids and live happily ever after. Well, Black Widow dies in his place. And it wasn't until the second time I watched the movie through that it just suddenly hit me. Isn't that exactly what Jesus did for you and me? And Hawkeye deserved to die. He didn't deserve to be forgiven and live happily ever after. But Natasha loved her friend. And even knowing what he had become, even knowing what he had done, she withheld judgment. She showed mercy and grace and then gave her life in his place. This is the gospel in a nutshell. Maybe you haven't gone on a violent killing streak, at least I hope you haven't, but you and I have sinned against God in so many ways, and we deserve to be punished for our sins. We don't deserve to live happily ever after in heaven. We don't, you know, deserve that happy ending. And yet Jesus came to earth full of grace and mercy and then gave his life in my place. We call that substitutional atonement. The Bible describes it this way in Romans chapter 5, beginning in verse 6. It says, "When we were utterly helpless, Christ came at just the right time and died for us sinners." Now, most people would not be willing to die for an upright person, though someone might perhaps be willing to die for a person who's especially good, but God showed his great love for us by sending Christ to die for us while we were still sinners. Now, my mistake was thinking that Hawkeye could redeem himself. He couldn't, and neither can we. You know, but just as Natasha gave her life to give Clint a second chance and a fresh start, Jesus gave his life to redeem you and me. And I can just sometimes imagine him staring at me saying, "I'm trying to save your life, you idiot." Of course, Hawkeye wasn't the only person that Natasha saved. At the beginning of the scene, Black Widow reminds Hawkeye, she says, if we don't get that stone, billions of people are going to stay dead. Because Natasha sacrificed her life to retrieve the Soul Stone, the Avengers were able to use the Infinity Stone, the Infinity Gauntlet, to restore everyone that Thanos snapped out of existence. She died so that billions of people could come back from the dead. And that's exactly what Jesus did. Jesus literally gave his life so that billions of people could be raised from the dead and given new life. He died so that we could live. So the deaths of these Avengers point us to Jesus in that they were voluntary deaths, they were vicarious deaths, and finally, they were also victorious deaths. While Black Widow's sacrifice made it possible for the Avengers to restore everyone that Thanos had snapped out of existence, Thanos himself remained a threat. You know, if he could get his hand on the Infinity Stones again, he could just, you know, do it all over again, just destroy the entire universe and start from scratch. And so the final victory doesn't come until Iron Man sacrifices his life. Let's watch one last clip from this movie together.
Mr. Stark. Hey. Mr. Stark, can you hear me? It's Peter. Hey. We won. Mr. Stark. We won, Mr. Stark.
For centuries, millennia, maybe. Thanos and his forces marched across the galaxies, conquering one world after another and killing half of their inhabitants with, you know, no apparent end to his reign. And so, sacrificing his own life in the process, Iron Man used the power of the Infinity Stones to defeat Thanos and his invasion forces, instantly turning them to ash. Incidentally, the name, the word Thanos, is the Greek word for death. It seems Marvel's Avengers and humanity in general share a common enemy. The Bible tells us in Romans chapter 5, verse 12, that sin came into the world because of what one man did, and with sin came death. This is why everyone must die, because everyone sinned. Since the Garden of Eden, death has been the arch enemy of humanity, and death always wins. I mean, think about it. The odds that you'll eventually die in a car crash are about 1 in 125. The odds that you'll die in a fire are about 1 in 4 million, which I like that. I'm okay with those odds. The odds that you'll be killed by a purple-tinged alien from outer space, probably nil. But the odds of you dying are 1 in 1. For millennia, death has stalked its prey with 100% success rate. To paraphrase Thanos, death is inevitable. It comes to every living thing. That is, until Jesus. As my shirt says, unlike Iron Man, when Jesus died to save the universe, he didn't stay dead. When Jesus got up and walked out of his grave, he conquered sin and death triumphantly. And in so doing, he opened the path to eternal life, to life without death. Looking forward to the second coming, to the return of Jesus, the Apostle Paul writes this in 1 Corinthians 15. He says, it will happen in a moment, in the blink of an eye, when the last trumpet is blown. For when the trumpet sounds, those who have died will be raised to live forever. And we who are living will also be transformed. For our dying bodies must be transformed into bodies that will never die. Our mortal bodies must be transformed into immortal bodies. Then this scripture will be fulfilled. Death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? For sin is the sting that results in death, but thank God, he gives us victory over sin and death through our Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus defeated death, literally Thanos. Jesus defeated Thanos so that we could live forever with him in victory. Eternal life is a free gift to those who put their faith in Jesus. He died for us, so let's live for him. So as I said, intentional or not, there are some poignant parallels between the deaths of these Marvel superheroes and the death of our mighty Savior. Their deaths were voluntary. Their lives were given, not taken. Their deaths were vicarious. They died so that others could live. And their deaths were victorious. They defeated the enemy and won the victory. And as I bring this Endgame series to a close, I want to thank you for joining me. I hope that the last few weeks have been both entertaining as well as enlightening for you. And I think it's surprising what we can learn about life, faith, and God when we view movies or music or other media through the lens of faith. If you're here today and you haven't put your faith in Jesus and accepted him as your Savior, just know that Jesus is Earth's mightiest hero, and he wants to be your hero too. He gave his life to save yours, and he invites you to enjoy eternal life with him. So if you want to accept that invitation, maybe you just need someone to walk you through it, then please come talk with me. You can pull me aside after church, or you can call me at home. My number's in the back of the bulletin, or you can just come forward and have a seat in the front row while we stand and sing together. Let's sing, church.